Today we're going to do two kind of nasty integrals and then go back to applications involving parametric curves, speed and distance traveled. These integrals are integrals of rational functions, so they're still ratios of polynomials. But, you know, these things are quite a challenge, so you need to just keep at it. For the first example, before I write down the integral, I'm going to give you some insight into how to make a problem involving integrals of the type that I want to show you here for the first example, where the function you're integrating is a rational function, a ratio of polynomials, and where the bottom can't be factored. How do I make a, in this case, quadratic that can't be factored? One way is to make sure that it has complex number solutions, not real number. And one way to do that is to, for example, write down, say, a positive number times x plus or minus something squared, let's say x minus 2 quantity squared, plus some other positive number. And I'm purposely picking these numbers, the number there and the number here, to be perfect squares because it makes the algebra work out more nicely. That's an example of a quadratic function that's got no real number roots. If you set this equal to 0 and try to solve for x, imagine doing that. I'm not literally going to do that, but imagine with me, set this equal to 0. You'd have to subtract 25 from both sides and then take the square root. But that means taking the square root of negative 25, which is not a real number. Another way to think about this is if you graphed it, it's graphed as a parabola opening upward because the coefficient of x squared is positive. And its vertex, its low point, will be when x is 2 and y is 25. It'll be above the axis and never go below. No x-intercepts, no roots. Real roots. The roots of this are complex numbers. If I now expand this, multiply it all out, that'll give me a quadratic that's the same quadratic, really, in standard form. However, this in standard form, it's not so clear that it doesn't have any real roots. Expand this out, FOIL this, I get x times x is x squared. Outside times outside is negative 2x, inside times inside is negative 2x, giving me minus 4x, and then last times last is negative 2 times negative 2 is positive 4. Now distribute the 9 through the parentheses to get 9x squared minus 36x plus 36 plus 25, giving me in standard form 9x squared minus 36x plus 61. That's a quadratic function in standard form that equals this one in vertex form. They are the same function. This one, it's pretty clear it's got no real roots, but in this form, you can't tell just by looking at it. If you tried the quadratic formula, you would get a square root of a negative number, and that would tell you it has no real roots. I'm not going to take the time to do that. That's what would happen if you did it. Why did I do this? Because I would now like to write an integral of a rational function. I'll make the numerator simple, 1. I'll make the denominator equal to this quadratic in standard form, 9x squared minus 36x plus 61. And that's the integral that we want to do now. The temptation is to look at this and say, oh, I guess this is a partial fraction problem. I must have to factor the bottom. But if you try that, you'll run into problems. You won't be able to factor the bottom. There's nothing you can do short of using complex numbers to factor the bottom. So you can't use partial fractions. So what do you use? Well, essentially what we do is we want to reverse what we did up here using a method called completing the square, which you thought you never have to see again before, but no, it comes back here. Complete the square. To write the bottom of the function like this instead of like that. And when it's in this form, hey, that's trig substitution, perhaps. actually we can get away without a trig substitution, but perhaps a trig substitution, something squared plus something else squared. One of the somethings involves the variable, one doesn't, one involves a constant. A trig substitution will work. And again, actually in this problem, you can avoid a trig substitution as well, but let's do it. But wait a minute. Can I just say, well, obviously that equals that? If you were given a problem like this, you wouldn't know that it equals that right away. You have to figure it out. That's where the completing the square comes into play. How do you do it? That's what I'm about to do right here. First of all, if the coefficient of x squared is something other than 1, in this case it's 9, factor that number out of the first two terms, not the last term. That 9, I'm going to factor out of the first two terms like this, 9 times in parentheses x squared minus 4x. Just leave the plus 61 out there. I made it nice, 36 is divisible by 9, but even if it were not, even if it were 37, you'd still do the same thing. If it were minus 37x instead of a minus 4x, you'd get like, what would it be? Minus 37 over 9x. It would be not so nice, but still doable. The next step is to take the coefficient of the x in here, which is this negative 4, divide it by 2, divide by 2 to get negative 2 in this case, and then square that number. Negative 2 squared is 4. It's just a coincidence with this example that these numbers are opposites. In general, they're not. If this had been, for example, minus 6x, negative 6 divided by 2 is negative 3. Negative 3 squared is positive 9. We would have gotten a negative 3 there, a negative 6 there, and a positive 9 there. They would not have been opposites of each other. They'd still have opposite signs in this case, but even in general, they don't have to have opposite signs. If this were a plus 4x, plus 4 divided by 2 is plus 2, 2 squared is 4, you'd get all plus signs. But that's the process, divide it by 2 and square it. After you've done that, what do? You complete the square. You put, take that number, whatever you got there, and add it right there. But wait a minute, is that allowed? Is that allowed? Doesn't that feel wrong? Mathematically wrong? Uh-huh.
It's not. If we subtract 9 times 4 is 36 on the outside.
Exactly. Compensate. This is adding 0 in a convenient way. By putting a plus 4 there, I've really added 36, 9 times 4. So I got to compensate by subtracting 36. And why do you do this? Because now this is a perfect square. It's x minus 2 quantity squared. And 61 minus 36 is 25. We got back to the original expression that I had up here. That's the process of how to complete the square. And whenever your quadratic in the denominator has complex roots, you've got to do that to help you do the integral. And you're hoping that the numbers turn out nice and no fractions and you're hoping numbers turn out nice. So what this means is this integral equals this integral. Now the quickest way to do this integral is with a plain old substitution. Though it probably would be ideal if we did that to factor a 25 out of the bottom first so that it becomes a 1 right there. You'd want to ultimately let W equal, it turns out 3/5 times in parentheses x minus 2. I'm not going to show you the details, even though that's probably the simpler way to go, because that's not what I did with the first class. And the reason I didn't do it with them, and I'm not going to do it with you, is because I want a little bit more practice with trig substitution. But that is probably the simpler way to go. And what that's hinting at is the answer involves inverse tangent, arctangent. Because you get something squared plus 1 in the bottom. And there's no square roots here, so you don't have to worry about square roots. However, for sake of being consistent with the previous class and also to be just practicing more trig substitution, let's do this with the trig substitution. Remember, last time I told you, when you have an expression of the form a squared plus y squared, where a is a constant and y is something that depends on x, actually, but that's a hint to let your substitution be y equals a tan theta. What is the a in this problem? 25 is 5 squared, so the a is 5. What is the y in this problem?
3 times x minus 2.
Exactly. 9 times x minus 2 squared is y squared. So y can be taken to be 3 times x minus 2, the square root. And you don't need absolute value symbols. So what this is telling me, if I do this, if I combine all this, this is tricky. I want to let y, which is 3 times in parentheses x minus 2, equal a 5 tan theta. That's the substitution in kind of a strange form. I'm looking at the pattern, comparing these. A is 5, because I got a 5, 25 is 5 squared. The y squared is this thing. Y depends on x. So y is the square root. You don't need absolute value signs. Y is 3 times x minus 2. It's kind of strange, yeah. But that's probably the best way to think about it. We can divide both sides by 3 first. And write x minus 2 is 5/3 tan theta. And then we also can add 2 to both sides if we like. X is 2 plus 5/3 tan theta. And that makes it a little easier to see that dx is going to be 5/3 secant squared theta, d theta. Really, what I'm doing there in going from here to here is I'm finding dx d theta, the derivative of x with respect to theta. The derivative of 2 is 0. The derivative of 5/3 tangent theta is 5/3 secant squared theta. And then I'm pretending to multiply both sides by d theta. It's not a literal multiplication. It's just a pretend multiplication that gets you to the right answer is the best justification for this at the moment. So now I do all these substitutions. Replace that dx there with 5/3 secant squared theta d theta. Replace the 25. Well, the 25 stays as is. Replace 9 times x minus 2 quantity squared with this thing squared, which means you'll replace it with 25 tan squared theta. 5 squared is 25. Tan squared theta. This is going to become the integral of 1 over 25 tan squared theta plus 25. Then dx gets replaced by 5/3 secant squared theta d theta, which looks really complicated, but this is going to simplify a lot to something very trivial. In fact, it's going to simplify, believe it or not, to a constant. Why? Well, this thing is the same as 25 times in parentheses tan squared theta plus 1. And remember, tan squared theta plus 1 is secant squared theta. And that makes the secant squared theta here and here completely cancel. Also, I can cancel this 5 with the 25 to leave a 5 in the bottom of the fraction. And 5 times 3 is 15 in the bottom, giving me a 1/15. I'm really integrating 1/15, which can be inside the integral or outside. This all simplifies just down to 1/15. And that's a very simple integral, 1/15 theta plus c. But we're not done. We need to replace theta with its dependence on x. We could use this equation to solve for theta in terms of x. Multiply both sides by 3/5. I guess I could have used the top one as well. Tan theta is 3/5 times in parentheses x minus 2. Theta is the inverse tangent of that, and I'll write that as inverse tangent of, I'll go ahead and multiply the 3 through the parentheses, 3x minus 6 all divided by 5. And that's what now goes there to give us a final answer of 1/15 times the inverse tangent of 3x minus 6 all divided by 5 plus c. Actually, if you're good enough at guessing integrals, and some people get really good at it, some people are able to look at this integral and guess that answer. But that takes a good amount of practice without bothering to do the substitution. It's got to involve an inverse tangent. The only question is what's inside there and what's outside there. That's the trickier part. Like I said 10 minutes ago, an ordinary substitution also works and perhaps is a little easier. Factor out a 25 out of the bottom, leaving a 9/25 x minus 2 quantity squared plus 1, and let w be square root of 9/25 is 3/5 times x minus 2 in parentheses. That would be w. You wouldn't have to bother with trig functions. But you'd still get the same answer in the end, because inverse tangent still is going to become involved. Mathematica does confirm this answer as being correct. Let's type it in there as the original integral. 1 over 9x squared minus 36x plus 61. There we go. That is the same. Mathematica doesn't bother multiplying the 3 through the parentheses. And again, you don't forget the plus c. Mathematica's assuming you know to add the plus c. Can I clarify anything there? So complete the square when you can't factor the bottom. And then either do an ordinary substitution or a trig substitution.